snow. The blood of Jesus, he died for you and me, oh, the blood of Jesus, thank you, Lord.
Pleasant good night to you out there in Radio Land. This is the Hour of Prayer coming to you from Faith Life Ministries. We thank you for your listening ears tonight. As we enter into our program tonight, we thank God for the opportunity to be in Radio Land one more time on Choice Gospel Network. This is Pastor Atwell and the panel coming to you another Tuesday night. May God bless your listening ears. May God bless those of you that are in your cars, on the internet, on the radio. We thank God for you tonight. Stay tuned tonight because we got a dynamic program for you as God will bless us to bring it to you tonight.
Jesus Christ of Nazareth, we thank you for this day that you have made. We thank you, Lord, that all things are in your hand. Surely, Lord God, earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. O God, thou art King of the weather. Thou art King of kings and Lord of lords. And as we come before you this evening, O God, we bring the listeners, those that are in the cars, in the home, wherever they might be listening. O God, we pray in the name of Jesus that we will be a blessing, O God, that we will be a son to them right now in the name of Jesus, and that, O God, we will fill the need as there is. O God, we thank you for your mercies. Thank you for your goodness. And we wait upon you, O God, to just let your Holy Spirit take charge of this meeting in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen.
No one else but you. I want no one else. No one else. No one else but you.
Oh, sure.
What is there else to want in this life but to want the great savior of this world? His name is Jesus. I heard a songwriter crying out that she wants Jesus. And it's one day I had that cry, having a need in my life and didn't know where to turn. I had to cry out to Jesus because it's the only name under heaven whereby we can be saved, we can be delivered, and we can be set free by that great name, that name which is above every name, the name of Jesus. So you out there in Radio Land tonight, you can call upon that name for your help. You can call upon that name for your deliverance. You can call upon that name for your healing, because that name is the name you need to call upon, the name of Jesus. We thank God tonight for another opportunity to be in your presence in Radio Land. This is Choice Gospel Network, and we are here tonight from Faith Life Ministries. Stay tuned with us tonight. Use your telephone tonight and call us with a testimony. Call us and say something to us tonight. We are glad when you call. We are happy when you call. We appreciate your call tonight. So call us. The number is 347-663-8638. And we know God is going to bless someone. Your testimony is going to lift someone a little higher. Your call is going to bless someone tonight. So call us at the radio station. I call that number again, 347-663-8638.
said you give me everything I need.
You give me everything I need.
Oh yeah.
Are you waiting on the Lord for tonight? He's able to deliver you. He's able to set you free. All you got to do is to call upon Him. He is able. He's able to deliver you. He's able to bring healing to your body. Are you believing God tonight for your healing? Are you believing Him for your deliverance? What is your need tonight? Do you need salvation? He's the salvation giver. Do you have hope in Him? He is the hope of our salvation. The Bible says to trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not unto your own understanding. Mm-hmm. In all your ways, acknowledge Him. If you acknowledge Him tonight, He will direct your path. He will set you free from every trial, from every tribulation, from every situation that you are going through, because He is an able God.
He is the God that we would trust in. He is the God that we can rely on. He is the God that Abraham looked to. He is the God that Jacob and Isaac looked to. He is the God that Moses looked to. He is the God that we are looking to now. He is the hope of the world. Without Him, we are lost. This is why He says, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I shall give you rest." The song said, and that's what I believe. You see, salvation involves believing. We must believe that Jesus is who He said He is. He's the author and finisher of our faith. He's the Lord that he's a reward of those who diligently seek him. And when you seek him, you find him, and then you believe who he is. You see, that is salvation, and you know, salvation is by faith. Our God is not a God that people put on a pedestal and we paint him every year so he looks beautiful, and you know, we put paint the eyebrows and his lips red in lipstick and that sort of thing, and we kneel to him and pay obeisance to him. We don't. That's not our God. That's a statue, that's a vain something, right? The God that we serve, we don't see him. Sometimes we don't even feel him, but we know.
Hallelujah.
This is important. Knowing God, you see, knowing God, knowing who and what you believe in, and you do it by faith. That Amen. Is what we believe. That is what we believe, that Jesus Christ came and he died for us. He died that we may live.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And the Bible says, on his time on earth, he did many, many miraculous things. Mm-hmm. He healed the sick. He opened the eyes of the blind. Mm-hmm. The lame walked. He walked on water.
Mm-hmm.
He demonstrated his power. He demonstrated his power. When demons came, he cast out demons. When they saw him, they spoke and said, you've come to destroy us mm-hmm. before our time. Right? Mm-hmm. And the Bible also said, that he died on the cross, and he said, it is finished. What was finished? Man's redemption mm-hmm. or the purpose in which he came was finished. Because he said, all power is given unto me mm-hmm. in heaven
and in earth.
Mm-hmm. And I now hold the key of life and hell. I hold that
yes.
key. He holds the key, meaning that the devil is thus imprisoned.
Mm.
Amen. He's not going to get off of that. He's not going to get off of that. Because there's coming a time. There is coming a time in the future when even the devil would be judged.
Hallelujah.
Remember what the demon said? Have you come to destroy us before
our time?
Because he knows that a time is coming, brothers
yes,
and sisters,
mm-hmm.
when he would be
mm-hmm.
destroyed. So we know in whom we believe. Bless you, bless you, bless you. God is good.
When you can move the mountains that's standing in your way, I came to tell you God can. I said God can.
Mm-hmm.
And when you can't turn your darkness into the light of day, I got good news for you. God can. God can. God can. God can. When you can't find the answers to all your doubts and fears,
God can.
Tell me,
God can.
When you are needing someone to wipe away your tears,
God can.
Yes, he can. Say,
God can.
Come on, say,
God can do more than you could ever ask or think.
Hallelujah.
He holds all power in his mighty hand. When you can't see your way, remember this, my friend, God can.
Yes, he can.
God can.
When you can't change your past and you can't heal your broken heart,
God can.
Somebody tell me,
God can.
Oh, yeah. When you can't find the courage to make a brand new start, say,
God can.
I know he can.
God can.
Your weakest,
mm-hmm.
he'll fill you with his strength. It's not by might, but by his spirit that we do all things. Yes, you can face the future when your hope is in his hand.
God can do more than
There's a question that was asked. Is there anything too hard for God to do?
Mm-hmm.
And I know beyond a shadow of a doubt that God can do all things. There is nothing that he can do. So don't matter what you're going through out there tonight. Don't matter what a situation you are in tonight. I want to let you know that he is able. The Bible says he's able to do abundant above anything that we may ask or even think. He knows your very thoughts.
You remember when Nebuchadnezzar had the dream, he was perturbed and worried, and he called all his charlatans and what have you, and soothsayers, and they couldn't do it. And he called Daniel.
That's right.
You know, as a matter of fact, he didn't know that Daniel had known the mighty God. He didn't know that Daniel, you know, had this direct contact with God.
Amen.
So someone told him, there's a guy here who has that contact.
Yes.
He said,
"Hallelujah."
He says, "Call him."
Yes,
and the wise men at the time agreed that he called Daniel, because Nebuchadnezzar told him, if I ain't get the dream, if you're not unable to, I'm going to kill you.
That's right.
So they said, tell us the dream and we'll give it interpretation. He said, no. If you're so wise, you must tell me what the dream is. They try one on him, but he threw back a ball. He said, no, if I tell you, then you could come up with anything, right? Because they've been doing that for years.
Yes.
He said, you must tell me the dream and the interpretation.
That's right.
So he put the same kind of threat to that condition to Daniel.
Mm-hmm.
And Daniel said, this is this. You say, listen,
mm-hmm.
the Lord God moves in the affairs of men.
Hallelujah.
He puts up and he brings down. Yes, this is it. He puts up. So God can do anything that he has promised to do.
Mm-hmm.
He moves in the affairs of men.
That's right. Amen.
He puts up and he brings down. That means he moved in the affairs of kings,
yes,
queens, mm-hmm. emperors, generals, presidents, everyone, yes, mayors, everyone.
He moving,
because their lifespan is in his hand.
That's right.
The if king they were so great, they shouldn't die, right? And they shouldn't do exactly what the poor people do, because they have to eat and they have to go to the bathroom.
No.
They have to do everything. All the functions that the poor man does.
And the rich man
must do it. Rich man. And then on top of it, he dies.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. On top of it, he dies. Or before he dies, he gets sick.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
That is so.
But tonight, I want to, you who are listening out there, I'm asking you to do something for me. This is Pastor Bash. I'm asking you to pray for me tonight. I'll tell you why. You see, my pastor's here saying that God can do all things. And I seem to disagree, because there are things that God cannot do. There is one. He cannot lie. And there's another thing he cannot do. Fail.
Amen. Amen.
So I want you who are out there listening, I need you to pray for me. I need you to call and talk. And let's talk about this. Because there are things that God cannot do. Lie and fail because of who he is. And that's why he says who he is. He says, I live forever. He says, I lift my eyes up to the heavens and say, I live forever. Because he is God. And isn't that great? That this great God has condescended to us, our men of low degree. What is man that thou art mindful of him? And the spirit of man that thou visitest him? Who are we that we can come here and talk about our God like we are talking about him now? Because he has condescended men of low degree. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. Good night. You're on Choice Radio. This is Faith Life Ministry, the hour of prayer.
Ah, good night. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Program.
It's always a pleasure listening to the Faith Life program. But, so Pastor Bass, I think the brothers, When they say that God can do anything, they're just talking about the omnipotence of God.
Amen.
See, you called. It's just not beautiful.
We didn't participate.
Yes, you called. You are participating.
In his will, right?
Amen.
Consistent with his character.
Mm-hmm.
Anything that could be considered good from a biblical standpoint that God can do.
Amen.
In an instant, and this is encouraging, actually. to know that the Christian at any point in time can be delivered.
Yes.
That is, regardless of what you're going through, mm-hmm. regardless of your condition, maybe your health condition, your financial situation, whatever it is, or your spiritual condition,
mm-hmm.
That in an instant,
mm-hmm.
God can change the whole thing.
Amen.
You just don't know when and how,
mm-hmm.
you know, but God specializes in just doing things in a certain way. You know,
yes.
You marvel
mm-hmm.
at how God turns something upside down, turn a situation
Amen.
From 90 degrees to
yes.
360 degrees.
Mm-hmm.
God just knows how to do that thing.
Yes. Really
good. And Job is a good example.
Yes.
In the Bible. And there are other examples.
All examples.
But the privilege, you know, something that was mentioned, you guys just mentioned in passing through, you know, you talk mm-hmm. with Daniel, and mm-hmm. he had direct contact with God. Yes. And recently I've been looking at the layout of the ancient temple, the Hebrew temple.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You know, when Judaism, what were in the dispensation of Judaism.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. That God accepted Judaism, and he had the temple set up a certain way, and... You know, there's certain parts of the temple that was really exclusive.
Yes.
Not for, I mean, it was for the priest, the high priest, as mm-hmm. a matter of fact, yes. and go in there once a year.
Yes.
At the time of atonement
mm-hmm.
and make confession and so on. And this is the man who had direct contact with God, you know. And everybody else had to be outside of that vicinity there. They can't go in there.
Mm-hmm.
He does the job.
Yes.
And but now... In this time,
go ahead, brother.
We have
direct
come boldly to the throne
yes.
of grace. Amen.
God.
Yes.
You know something?
Mm-hmm.
I don't think a lot of us Christians really take that into consideration and reflect mm-hmm. on that and be serious or react and respond to that, you know, as true reality. You know, I don't think so.
Mm-hmm.
You know that we have direct, like Daniel.
Yes.
Not everybody in the Old Testament, not everybody in the Old Testament that is direct contact like
yes.
Daniel.
No.
Yes.
You know?
Mm-hmm.
Just the prophets and, you know, Daniel was one of them. Anyway,
mm-hmm.
But today now,
yes.
you're born again. You're
yes.
born of the Spirit of God.
Yes.
Right? The indwelling Spirit lives in you. You
mm-hmm.
are in Christ.
Mm-hmm.
You have direct contact with
yes.
the God who created the heavens and the earth.
Yes. Hallelujah.
I mean, it's a
mind-boggling
thing because...
Mm-hmm.
Knowing the kind of God that this God of the Bible is, that
mm-hmm.
is the true and living God, of course.
Mm-hmm.
Knowing when you really consider His ways,
mm-hmm.
His works, and you consider the creation, you consider just about everything, the whole we reveal
mm-hmm.
the whole Scripture from Genesis to just about everything, and you know now
mm-hmm.
that you and I are in this
mm-hmm.
position that we have direct contact with
mm-hmm.
him, that we
mm-hmm.
go to him in the name of Jesus Christ,
yeah, yeah.
and we can get prayers through, and we can get prayers answered. And you know what we could do? We can also know in the Spirit
mm-hmm.
what move we should make, what direction
mm-hmm.
we can know in the Spirit, because God reveals it to us
yes.
what we should do.
You know what's the amazing thing, brother?
It's a great, a tremendous privilege,
mm-hmm.
you know, through Jesus Christ, and we
mm-hmm.
just give Jesus the glory because
Amen.
It's through Him.
Amen.
It's through Him this has been achieved, that we can be benefactors of this direct
yes.
contact with the supreme, divine,
supreme.
Holy God that
Amen.
That we can't see, but
yes.
it's so real.
No wonder He calls us sons and daughters and heirs of the kingdom.
And joint heirs.
And joint heirs with Jesus Christ. Isn't that beautiful?
You know what I mean?
Amen.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The thing about it is that we don't have to get up and go to the tabernacle no more.
No.
We actually tabernacle with Him.
Amen. Amen. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
And this is what God has been
Hallelujah.
Trying to achieve all the
all
time.
All the time from
this
Genesis.
Is what this is what He expressed.
This is it.
This is what He expressed
Hallelujah.
Through Adam. Through Adam. And Adam had direct contact with God.
Yes.
Communication with God. Right through.
Mm-hmm.
He expressed this all the time.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
He expressed this all the time. You
and
know.
Now we go right
yeah,
back
right
now
back.
To Genesis.
Yes.
We go yeah. right back now to Genesis. And now God has made a way that we can come back.
Boldly,
and that's
yes,
the subject. Yes. Repentance.
Repentance. Yes.
When we repent, we can come back.
Amen.
Although we move
Amen.
Away
Amen.
A little
Amen.
Bit.
Amen.
We move from the lane. I just came from a road trip. And it says, stay on your lane.
Yes.
And we are told to stay on our lane, but sometimes we move off.
The whole concept of repentance is it is necessary for the attainment of salvation.
That's right.
If you don't repent, you're not going there.
That's correct.
Remember what he told Solomon after Solomon gave that long, fabulous prayer?
Yes.
If my people,
who are called by my name,
shall humble themselves,
pray, seek,
and
turn from them. Because you see, a righteous man fall how many times? Once, right? No, seven times.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen. The Christian lives.
Yes.
Not, you know, Bible, we encourage, I think, by one of the apostles saying, hey, quit living like men.
Yes.
Amen. Quit you.
Yes, sir.
Living like men.
Yes,
that
sir.
Is, in other words, the Lord is saying, don't live like how you used to live, like regular men. You're not regular men anymore.
No.
You know what you are now?
Yes, sir.
You are sitting in heavenly places
in with Christ Jesus.
Yes, brother.
So our life is really,
yes,
we move in a physical form, but we're really spiritual people.
Amen.
Spiritual people with direct contact with God and having this sense, not the sense of bliss, but really having the blessings
really
of God.
Really having it, brother.
I mean, in a very, very abundant and real way.
Yes.
We're not like ordinary men. That's why we exhorted, quit living like men, because we're not like regular men if you're
Hallelujah.
Born again.
Hallelujah.
And tonight I want to encourage Christians who are listening and ourselves that we should really take advantage of this privilege and be grateful. And in addition to that, cherish the privilege. You know what could really swat the privilege and kind of contaminate the whole thing and make us ineffective sin.
Of course,
let us really strive to live above sin and refute it and you know stand in purity and holiness before God so that we can really make maximum use of the direct contact with God for His glory and honor.
You're putting it together rightly, brother.
We have to put aside every weight.
Okay,
amen. Wonderful.
Put aside. Lay aside every weight, right?
Wonderful.
Good. I'm so glad you called.
It's a good thing, Pastor Bash, you provoked some thought just now. So the brother responded, amen. That's good.
you know, Pastor Pastor Bash did bring a point, and she spoke about staying in your lane.
In your lane. Mm-hmm. Yes,
and that brought the thought to me. The reason why Christians are going through so much problems because they don't stay in their lane. They come out of their lane and they meet accidents.
You cut out. Yes.
Some serious accidents when you come out of your lane.
Yes.
Some of us die because of those accidents. Some of us are sick because of those accidents. Some of us are going through trials and tribulations because of some of those accidents. I like that. Stay in your lane.
And you know what? You know what brought it home to me? It always does. Ever since the death of Princess Di and where she died.
In the tunnel.
When you are in a tunnel, what do? Tell me.
Stay in your lane.
You better. Because you may never come out. Alive.
Stay in your lane.
You've got to stay in your lane. And we are in a tunnel. Because you know why? Because the Bible talks about two ways. Narrow and broad. And when you're in the narrow, you have to stay. And the brother said it. Lay aside every weight. And that the sin that so easily besets you. And let us run with patience.
Yes.
The race that is set. And you know he's coming soon. We see it.
You see, Christians ought to put on blinders, you know. Because we are in a race.
That's right.
The things that, you know, I was telling a brother yesterday, and I asked him, what do you think obstacles are? Couldn't answer. I said, obstacles, listen, are what you see when you remove your eyes from the goal. When your eye is on Christ, the obstacles would always come. They're always there.
They're always there.
I understand this.
There.
If your eyes are not on Christ and your eyes are on something else, part of the world, you still have obstacles.
You still have obstacles.
So that if your eyes are on Christ and your obstacle come, when you remove that eyes from Christ, then you remove eyes from the goal. You keep your eyes on the goal and the goal and the goal. That's the goal. Up and down.
That reminds me of a hurdler who didn't train properly.
Yeah, properly. Yeah. All right. You're going to fall down. You're going to trip and fall.
All right.
You trip and fall. You're going to trip and fall.
You're
going to trip and fall.
Hallelujah. Call us. Let us talk again. 347-663-8638. Hallelujah.
Join the conversation.
Hallelujah.
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 I cannot explain the way your spirit works, the way your grace flows to me. It's not hard to understand why you've held my hand and lift my whole life up from the ground. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. There is no love like your love. It's all so pure and true. It makes my heart brand new. There is no love like yours. I surrender all to you. Yeah. I cannot explain the way your favor works, the way your gifting flows to me. It's an honor to be chosen to lead by your commission and take the message of salvation to this dying world. Oh Lord, I can never fully explain, but it's by your spirit I understand. There is no love.
Great love. What a love that a man can sacrifice his only begotten son. God sent his only begotten son into this world that I might be saved, that I might be set free from all my troubles and all my pains and all my hurts and all my misery. Oh, what a great love. I mean, can I love someone like that? I don't know. Pastor Bash, can I?
I don't know.
Now we're going to ask our own Sister Whistling to step in and talk to you tonight.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. You know, it's beautiful what God says. Just before Sister Whistling comes on, just to let you know what Jeremiah 33c says. I have loved you with an everlasting love, and with loving kindness I have drawn you. And this is the God that we serve. We know whom we have believed in, and we are persuaded that he is able to keep that which we have committed unto him against that day. Hallelujah. We thank God for the night. Here is our dear Sister Whistling. Hallelujah. Jesus.
Praise the Lord. You know, we serve a God that is more than enough for every situation. Because the Bible says that, and as the songwriter was saying, we serve a God that loves us with an everlasting love. There is no end to his love. No matter what situation, no matter how low you might reach, and how low and the ground you may be lying,
that love is still
dear to pick you right back up. That's an everlasting love. And what we talk about everlasting, we mean from beginning to end. And he will stand with you whatever situation you are in. All you got to do is to call upon him in the time of trouble and call upon him in the time of your need. And you have needs out there tonight. You are in trouble tonight, and you need to call upon the name of Jesus. That great and powerful and mighty name. You see, sometimes we just call that name casually, Pastor.
Oh, yes.
But you've got to call that name from deep down within the recesses of your soul, knowing and having the belief that he's able. That he's able, and that he will hear your heart's cry. You see, this is not a mouth thing.
No.
This is a heart thing.
Yes. Yes. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Bless the Lord. We thank God for tonight. We thank God for you. We really want you to call in and take part in this program. And like Pastor Atwell was saying, it's not a mouth thing. It's a hard thing. He says, if you seek me, you will find me.
Amen.
When you search for me with all your heart. And that's what he wants from us. He wants all of us. That's the thing about it, you know. Our God is not satisfied with 75%. He wants 100%. Because you know why he wants 100%? Because he gave 100%. Amen. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And he says this life is in his son, and we can experience that life. Remember what the brother was saying just now? His spirit is in us. Yes. His spirit works within us. That's why it's not by might.
It's not by power.
It's only by his spirit. You know what I thank God for? Brothers and sisters, friends outside there in the listening audience. You know what I thank God for? He is the greatest orchestrator. He is the greatest in orchestrating. He orchestrates everything. One preacher man said, he's a God of strategies.
Amen.
That's the God that we serve. I don't know how many of you listened to the program this morning with the Prime Minister of Israel, Benjamin Netanyahu. And when he spoke about Esther, God is the greatest orchestrator that you can think about. And you know, everything that is going on, he knows about it.
Amen.
He knows about it, but he is going to do what he has to do when he has to do it. And we cannot tell him when to work, but we can ask him, we can pray and ask him to be merciful to us. And David says it, I would rather fall in the hands of God than in the hands of men, because God is merciful. Call us. Let us talk a little bit about our God. This is why we're here, with all the weather that is going on outside. That is why we're here, to talk about our God. Hallelujah.
David said in Psalms 15, Lord, who shall abide in thy tabernacle?
Yeah,
who shall dwell in thy holy hill? He that walk uprightly and worketh righteousness and speaketh the truth in his heart. Like I said before, it's a heart thing. It's not a mouth thing. We thank God tonight for this opportunity. You are listening to the Hour of Prayer coming to you live from Faith Life Ministry on Choice Gospel Radio. We want you to call us tonight at 347-663-8638. Get into the conversation tonight. Join with us. Join with us. We're looking forward to your call tonight because God is about to do something in your life. And you got to know that he will do whatever you ask him to because he's that type of God.
Hallelujah. Amen. God is a good God.
Yes.
Hallelujah. It's so nice to know that we've been able to come into your homes and in your presence and share our experiences with you to let you know that the God of the Bible is the same God that we are sending to you, offering to you tonight. It's the same God that is willing to come into your heart. We've been repeating it every week. Revelation 3:20. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. Mm-hmm. If anyone hears my voice, let him open up the door of his heart and come in with him. I would come in and I sup with him and he with me. Mm-hmm. And it's a relationship thing. God is a relational God. He wants to have fellowship. Indeed, this is why you were created, to have fellowship with the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. To have fellowship. Amen. Amen. It was broken temporarily. But in the fullness of time, God sent his Son, born of a woman, under the law to redeem those who were under the law of the curse. Amen. So we have been redeemed. Not with corruptible things as silver and gold, but with the incorruptible blood of Jesus Christ. We have been redeemed. Hallelujah. So that whole concept of fellowship, amen, has gotten together. Amen. So we are now fellowshipping with God. Fellowship. God. Amen. Koinonia. We are now fellowshipping with God. He said, because he said, I'm going to sup with you and you with me. This is why we take the communion. As often as we do it in remembrance of him, right? He says, as often as we do it every day, every week, every month, but we still do it. He says, as often as you do it, they leave to you to do it. It's a fellowship thing with God. It's a and you know, I'm looking at the, I remember reading something today. I was reading the commentary of Jimmy Swaggart and Revelation. And he was talking about billions of people that are serving their so-called gods, but yet still do not have a fellowship with your God.
Okay, now
they serve him. As I said just now, they paint the gods, right? They paint the god like you know, and some of their gods short and fat, big eyes, long ears, and bulging, you know, long nose.
They plenty
hands. They paint their gods. They can see the god. They paint the god, right? They paint the god. Sir. We cannot see a God, yet still we enjoy a fellowship with God. Amen. That's salvation by faith. We do not see him. No one has seen God.
No one has seen God.
No. But yet still we know he is there.
Yes.
Because when he comes into your heart, there is a change. There is a change. There is a change. There is a change. There is a change in your life. And you know. It's like a woman knowing that she is pregnant. Don't care what the doctor says. She knows that she's because there's a change in her. She feels that change. She feels the movement. She feels the kicking of the child and the wiggling of the baby. She feels that. And in the fullness of time, when she goes, the doctor says, yes, you are. So she knows. So that when you accept Christ, it's not a feelings thing. It's a change of heart. It's a change of attitude. It's a change of commitment. It's a change of lordship from the lordship of Satan to the lordship of Christ. It's a change, right? Hallelujah. And you know for sure, without a shadow of a doubt, that we say there's no doubt in your mind, you know, yes, I have been redeemed.
And the thing about it is that when you have been redeemed, there's no doubt in your mind that you have, because God reveals himself to you.
To you, of course.
You know? And you, then after that, you know beyond a shadow of a doubt that things is going to get better.
Of course.
Because once God comes into your life, it cannot get worse. It could only get
better. Well, I think we need to clarify. When we say things, not necessarily material things.
Not material things. Not necessary material.
No, sir. No, sir.
I'm talking about your life.
Your spiritual life.
You're talking about that peace. Amen. That peace, all understanding that everything is going.
On the contrary, when you get saved, you may lose
wrong.
Your job.
That's right. Everything
you may lose your job.
Seems to be going wrong.
Your brothers and sisters get.
Yes, sir.
Remember, he said, I came to bring a sword.
That's correct.
That's enmity we're talking about. Yes, that's war, right? Yes.
And a man's enemies are who?
Yeah.
Those of his household.
Also, listen, I have so many people I have known who said when they got saved, they lost their girlfriend.
Yes.
They lost their boyfriend. Mm-hmm. The brother stopped talking to them. Our own bishop.
Yes.
Remember the father and mother said, not in this house. Remember, I said, not in this house. She said, not in this house. We are so and so and so. The church on here, last church, you know. This is so. He said, I came to bring a sword when you receive Christ as Savior, because you know you are saved. You don't want to go back there.
Yes.
The enemy now, he would invoke jealousy in the other people, and they come to you, right?
Yes. Amen.
He invoked them and they come to you. They are against you now. Why did you do this? Why did you do that? And right it starts, right? Mm-hmm. Of your own household.
That's correct.
So that when you accept Christ, yes, you have the peace of God that passes all understanding.
Mm-hmm.
But understand to know the devil is mad.
That's right.
And the people who you thought had loved you will turn against you. You lose your friends. I had to change some of my friends.
Mm-hmm.
You lose your friends. You lose your this and you lose your that. But because you have the peace of God, you cannot be derailed. If you keep your eyes upon him, you cannot be derailed at all, at all. You cannot be derailed.
Mm-hmm.
That's why many people withdraw from God, because when they're praying for something, they're always hoping for something material, like house, cars, and anything. But God is bigger than that.
Amen.
That's the problem. God is bigger than anything, house, cars, or anything that you think, like for ladies, clothes, and jewelry. People always thought about bringing those things in when they're praying. They always thought that will come. I'm praying for a house. I'm praying for a car. But think about when Jesus was there. What he has?
Nothing.
As a king, he has nothing. And then he's gone. That's the problem. That's the purpose of us in this earth. We're not supposed to worry about so many material things. Pray for our soul. So when God comes, he can get us the way we're supposed to be.
Amen.
Not thinking about what I'm left behind. So many people say, I'm not going to work for nobody because I don't want to leave no money for nobody. This is about what you left over for God, what you did. How can you convince somebody to God? This is what happened right now. Just praying for something better than material thing.
Hallelujah.
You see, because the Bible tells us, if we live righteous,
yes,
if we live holy, if we do the things of God, if we speak his word, we testify about him, witness for him, we don't have no worry. All those material things will be added onto us. It becomes like an addition. We don't have to work hard for it.
I think it's so beautiful. He says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. You know, it's amazing. That verse came last in Matthew 6.
Yes.
But if you go from beginning to see what began before that verse came, he says, don't worry about, take no thought.
Your heavenly Father knows what you want.
About what you're going to eat, what you're going to wear, what you're going to put on. He says, look at the lilies. They don't worry.
Amen.
Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed or dressed up like one of these. The sister talk about clothes. What is clothes? For shards. Because you can put clothes on a body that's dirty.
Amen.
You can put clothes on a body that is so distressed. But when you have Jesus in your life,
you are clothed in righteousness.
There you go.
You know what? Even when he sent the disciples out, Pastor Bash, what he told them, he says, take nothing.
That's what he told them.
Take nothing with you. In other words, they're only saying that when you go out there, all your needs will be met. Supplied.
That's right. And that's the truth, you know. That's the truth. And that's why David says, taste, you know. David says, taste and see. He means to say, put him on the test. Put God.
Put him on trial.
Put him on, taste and see that the Lord is good.
It's a kind of Elijah trial. It's a kind of Elijah trial, you know.
Yes.
He was one person, and he had how much? 450 prophets.
That's right.
He was one person against 450 prophets. Amen. You see what Elijah knew? The God in whom he believed.
He really knew the God.
He knew God because God had been there for him
all the time.
He tested God. At every occasion he tested God. He experienced the goodness of God and the miracle working God. He experienced all that.
Hallelujah.
So it would have been, you know. So he knew that. So when the 450 false prophets come to him and he said, okay, we're going to work with you. Yes. You know, we're going to work with you. Do so and so and so. Test by fire.
Yes.
A test by fire.
Yes.
Amen. A test by.
Hallelujah.
It's a test by fire.
Yes.
It's a test by fire. Let's see what God can do.
Yep.
And if, listen, it could have been any other test. God would have come true.
Yes.
Because he's the God of the universe.
Oh, yes.
It could have been any other test. God would have come through. It's a test that they approved of. They choose it. Okay. It could have been that they've been accustomed working there. Listen, at times you must understand this. In the book of Kings, it talks about the, I think it's the Assyrian king. When the battle was going against him, he took one of his sons and sacrificed him to the gods. And then the battle turned against Israel. Yes. In 2 Kings, in Kings. And the battle turned against Israel. So they have been accustomed sacrificing these things to their gods. They've been accustomed sacrificing children and human beings to God. So they say, okay, let's do a burnt offering, make a sacrifice. They're accustomed to sacrifices. Listen, God is going to beat you at your own game.
Oh, yes.
He's going to beat you at your own game, right?
He said that.
And then the Spirit of God told Elijah, okay, besides the fire, let's show the water too. Amen. Water without fire. He said, fill it with water.
That's right.
Fill it with water. If you think I have some kind of extra light or trick up my sleeve, put water. Water outs fire.
That's
we always know that, right? Fire doesn't consume water. Water outs fire.
Hallelujah.
And then what happened? What happened? The Bible tells us what happened, right? The fire came and consumed the water.
Consumed the water.
Consumed the water. That shows the goodness of God.
Yes.
It shows the... You see, in these times, brothers and sisters, audience, God is not going to send fire to burn any water. No. God is not going to prove himself. He proves himself by walking in you, by cleaning you up, by taking you off the street, by turning the mind. You remember that testimony we had on Sunday?
Yes.
Of the young man who was sick? Amen. God turned him around.
That's right.
This is what happened. This is how God is going to test himself. This is how he tests himself. This is how he's going to test himself, right? Through his goodness and through his mercy. He saves everyone. Everyone. That's the goodness of God and the mercies of God in existence.
Yes.
If you are out there this afternoon and you figure you have no entitlement, I want to let you know you have a God who is waiting to hear your heart's cry. Cry out unto him today, because he is waiting to hear from you. You are out there in Radio Land and you are going through situations, you are going through problems. We want you to call us tonight, because we serve an able God.
Yes.
Listen, we can't do anything, but we know a God who can.
Who can.
Amen.
We know a God who can.
Hallelujah.
It's not us going to do it, but he uses us as vessels and to bring forth his kingdom into this world. Join us tonight at 347-663-8638. I'm going to play this song and we're going to go straight into the Word of God.
Hallelujah.
It's your nephew. Word of God, Donnie. Now, I know things in the world looking crazy right now, and you don't know what's going to happen next. Word of encouragement for you, boo. Uncle Donnie, sing.
Ooh, child, things are gonna get easier. Child, things will get brighter.
Yes, sir.
Ooh, child, things are gonna get easier. Ooh, child, things will get brighter.
Talk to him.
Someday, yes, we'll put it together and we'll get. The beautiful sun.
people dying, come on, come on. If you're tired of the fighting, come on, come on. No more wars, no more lying, come on, come on. All my people in the world, come on, come on. Every boy, every girl, come on, come on. If you know it ain't over till God says that it's over, come on, come on. Come on, let's go.
That day is the Hallelujah. Day when you accept Jesus Christ mm-hmm. as your Lord and mm-hmm. Savior.
Hallelujah.
That's the day when everything Someday. Begins to change.
Mm-hmm.
That's the day when time stops
mm-hmm.
and your life changes totally, Pastor
Pete. Now begins.
It now begins. New life begins.
Newness of life. The Bible calls it newness of life.
Tonight we are in the book of Chronicles, 2 Chronicles.
Hallelujah. Chapter 33.
Second Chronicles chapter 33, and I'm going to read from verse 10 mm-hmm. to mm-hmm. verse 19.
No.
Verse, 20? Just a few 13, verses. 13. You only read it here, see right
10 to 13. That's three verses.
Huh?
10 to 13.
10 to
13.
13. Yes, yeah, sorry. Yeah. And it says thus, Second Chronicles mm-hmm. chapter 33, verse 10 to 13. And the Lord spake unto Manasseh and to his people, but they would not hearken.
Mm-hmm.
Wherefore the Lord brought upon them the captains of the host of the king of Assyria, which took Manasseh among the thorns and bound him with fetters and carried him to Babylon. And when he was in affliction,
mm-hmm.
he besought the Lord his God and humbled himself greatly before the God of his fathers
mm-hmm.
and prayed unto him, and he was entreated of him and heard his supplication
mm-hmm.
and brought him again to Jerusalem into his kingdom.
Hallelujah.
Then Manasseh knew that the Lord, he was God.
Hallelujah.
Go ahead, Amen. Pastor Pete.
Hallelujah.
Amen. This is a typical example of the process of repentance, what we've mm-hmm. been talking about. Now, Manasseh's father, Hezekiah, was unto death in Isaiah 38.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And the Lord told Isaiah the prophet, mm-hmm. go and tell him to put his house in order.
Elijah.
Mm-hmm. Elijah.
Mm-hmm.
Isaiah.
Mm-hmm.
The Lord told Isaiah, go and tell Hezekiah
mm-hmm.
that
mm-hmm.
put his house in order for right. tomorrow he
That's
died.
That's right.
Right? And because Hezekiah knew the Lord his God,
mm-hmm.
he knew God,
mm-hmm.
he did not accept what the prophet said. At times you don't have to accept what mm-hmm. people say. If you know where you are standing in God, if you know where you are in God, you don't mm-hmm. have to accept it, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the Bible says he turned his face to the wall. He turned his back to the situation. And he faced God. He faced God, right?
Mm-hmm.
And we don't know what he said. But let's remember this.
Mm-hmm.
The psalmist says, Psalm 91, 16 said, with long life would I bless you
mm-hmm.
and show you my salvation.
Yes.
And Hezekiah was possibly around 55. He was not that old. Because the Bible had promised, 70 years,
yes.
right?
Mm-hmm.
So he must have told the Lord all that.
Yes.
And God told, the Bible said God heard his prayer.
Mm-hmm.
Tell the prophet, go back and tell Hezekiah,
mm-hmm.
I would add 15 more years to his life.
Yeah.
Indeed, he did.
You know what's amazing about that, Pastor mm-hmm. Pitt? The prophet didn't even reach far. And no. That's just to show you how God answers prayer.
Effective prayer. While he was walking.
That's going, right. Yes.
Mm-hmm. The Lord says, stop, turn back.
Yes, sir. Go and tell him.
Go and tell him. So and so, I shall add. I have seen his prayers and his tears.
Yes.
He said, go and tell him. And he said, the Lord would add 15 years. Now, I've been telling people sometimes it's good to be careful what you ask God for. Because in that process, this is how we arrive at Manasseh.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
He had Manasseh, his son.
Yes, sir.
Manasseh was the worst king that Israel produced.
Ever had, yes.
He ruled Israel for 55 years. He was just 20 years of age.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. 20 years of age when he became king.
Mm-hmm.
And he reintroduced all the wickedness, all the false God, all the worship, all those things, the sacrifices to Moloch.
Yeah.
He reintroduced all the things that his father had dissolved and banned. Correct. He reintroduced it.
Yes.
He reintroduced it. He made Israel to sin. Israel had 27 kings.
And he was the worst. He was the worst king. Yeah.
God's heart was grieved. Yes. He was grieved. And the question is, why did God allow him to reign for so long?
Okay.
55 years.
That's correct.
Amen. Remember we said just now that the Lord God rules in the affairs of men. He puts up
and he
brings down all for his honor and glory.
All
for his honor and glory.
Yes, sir.
So that those who are coming after Manasseh would know that Lord is God. He is God and he does whatever he wants to do. Worldwide, God, I remember last year, year before, Pastor Hagee made a statement that God allowed
mm-hmm.
Hitler to murder those Jews, and it was an uproar.
Okay.
They said he was heretic, he was talking heresy, he didn't know he was saying that if God allowed it, God had no conscience, so and so and so.
Mm.
Of course, God has a conscience, but God allowed it.
Mm-hmm.
God allowed it. What has become of Hitler and the others? What have become of those people, right? Amen. 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 There are certain things because of God's permissive will, God allows it to happen. We know that he has a perfect will, but because of his permissive will, he allows it to happen. He allowed Manasseh to reign for 55 years.
No wisdom, no counsel.
No, that's it. 55 years.
And go ahead. And that was, and we know, be honest, from the word of God, that was punishment for even Israel from turning from the law.
That's of course. Yes. They turned from the law of
Moses.
They turned from the law.
And God raised up this king.
Yes.
Who,
yes.
After his father being such a good man of God and a good prophet and everything, has raised up this king from, you know, to be a punishment to Israel.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yes. He forsook all the counsel of his father. Hezekiah, and reintroduced the body Bible called the groups, and the secret places, and the secret order, and the astrologers, and all. He reintroduced
everything,
that. And the sacrifice idols, and sacrifice of babies to Moloch.
Yes,
or when God had forbidden them, don't do that. He reintroduced it for 55 years. So you see the intensity of the sin. One generation had gone and another generation had born into that. This is what they knew. This is what they were trained in.
Wow.
The Bible says, train a child in the way that you should go, so when you go up, you shall not depart. The Israelites trained their children in idol worship. And so this is all that they knew. This is all that they know. So that if you're listening, if you're training your children contrary to the will of God, and then when they would have grown up, they do something contrary to the will of God, don't hold your head and ball. This is how you train them. If he sees you beating up his mother, your wife, your son is going to do the same thing.
Yes.
Right? Your daughter would think that is acceptable for a man to beat her up.
Yes.
This is all she knows. This is all she saw.
Sure. Yes.
Oh, you understand this?
Yes.
This is so. Yes. This is so. So that this is not the kind of training God is talking about. The Bible says that Manasseh, this is all he did. But then there's a cutoff point with God.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
There's a time when your sins will reach God's nostrils. Yes. Amen. Yes. There was a cutoff time with the Sodom and Gomorrah, right?
Yes.
There was a cutoff time in the times of Noah. There was a cutoff time with Pharaoh.
Yes.
And he told Moses, go tell Pharaoh, let my people go. Yes. 430 years had passed. There's a cutoff time with God. You see, God does not measure time as we measure time.
Yes, because he knows the times. He knows the seasons.
That's right.
When he's ready to act. Right.
That's correct.
55 years is an extremely long time. There are very few monarchs in the world not ruling for 55 years. Well, Queen Elizabeth has reached her 60th year. Yeah. Very, very, very few monarchs now are ruling for 55 years. God allowed him to rule for 55 years because there's a reason. There's a reason for that, right?
Purpose. God has a purpose.
There's a time. Yes. There's a season for everything.
Yes.
A time to build up and a time to break down. A time to cry and a time to laugh. A time to weep and a time to mourn. There's a season for everything. God allowed that, right? God's plans were in motion. His plans were in motion, right? And then God allowed the Assyrians. Mm. God allowed the Assyrians to attack Jerusalem. Took him as prisoner. A king is no prisoner. The Bible talks about they put a hook in his nose, in his nostrils.
Yes.
A hook as a common and pull him by that.
Pull him like a farmer will pull a cow.
Cow, yes. Cows are, we put hooks in cow's nose and pig nose and pull them so that they would behave themselves. Yes. When they fight you, just pull it and they run to you. They submit their will. That is to submit their will. Don't care how bad they are. When you put that hook and you pull it, they are submissive to you. Wow. This is what was done to this king.
Yes.
Don't forget that. Israel's king. This is what was done to this king. Amen. And in the time of crisis and great distress.
Yes.
In the time of crisis and great distress. You see, 55 years he ruled. He paid no respect to God, no homage to God.
And Pastor P, the thing about it is that he knew God.
He knew, of course.
His father was Hezekiah. Yes.
Could we say then that because a seed was planted, just like the prodigal son.
Yes.
Look at the degradation. Look at the level.
Yes.
Yesterday I was reading about the Forbes best of billionaires in the world. And I see Michael Jordan eventually made it.
Wow.
Billionaires. The prodigal son, based on the day's economy, his father was a billionaire.
Yes.
His father was a billionaire. Based on that day's economy, his father was a billionaire. And he ate and fared sumptuously.
Mm-hmm.
He ate well. He slept well. He had the best things in life. But he sought to go a wrong way. But because the seed was planted.
Yes.
The seed was planted in him. What is the seed? The consciousness of God.
Yes.
The consciousness of God in you. Sometimes you forget it, but it's there.
It's there.
Sometimes you forget it, or you disregard it, but it is there.
Amen.
It's a discipline that's planted in you, right? It's a resolve that's in you.
Because, Pastor, but even if we look at some of us who are saved today, our parents did not really know a lot of truth that we know today.
But you know what?
They planted a seed.
Yes.
They planted a righteous seed. Yes. They didn't plant a rebellious seed.
No.
They planted a humble seed.
Yes.
You know, they told us, the what we call the golden words.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, thanks, please. Mm-hmm. Good morning, good afternoon. Mm-hmm. We were taught that.
Respect one another.
Respect each other.
Respect your grown-ups.
Respect your grown-ups. Correct. Don't curse your elder, so on.
Good seed.
A good seed. This good is seed. The seed that was planted.
Yes, sir.
Don't steal anything from anyone you ask and all that kind of thing. That's the seed that they planted.
Mm-hmm.
So that if that is planted in you, we call it core values.
Yes.
Okay. That forms a basis of your growth.
Mm-hmm.
It's the foundation in your life. When that is planted, no matter where you go, you always remember that. You reflect on it.
Yes.
And God has something to work with.
Of course. So you have something to reflect on, right?
Mm-hmm.
So the prodigal son, a billionaire son, took his part of the estate and he went.
Mm-hmm.
We know the story. But he had to go through great pain. Denials, right? Sacrifice. He had to mix with, and it became a curse because as a Jew, he had to mix with pigs.
Yes.
That itself is an abomination.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
He had to mix with pigs. Listen, the Bible talks about fellow called Antiochus Epiphanes in BC 165 when he invaded Jerusalem, and the Maccabees, Judas Maccabees and his son fought him. He desecrated the temple. Mm. What he did, he took swine meat and hung it up in the temple. Christ was referred to that, the abomination that caused desolation.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And what is abomination? Anything that pollutes, that which pollutes, is an abomination. So that the prodigal son became an abomination to his father when he went and he ate with the swines. He probably had to sleep with them too.
Of course.
Amen. Some time ago, I listened to a testimony of a guy from Brooklyn Tab who knew the Lord and had backslided. He took cocaine and went. Eventually, he started to sleep with the dogs in the kennel. And he was smelling like them, the dog filth and everything. And his wife never gave up. Never. His name was Calvin Hunt, a wonderful singer. Never give up. She would pray. And I saw the film. The pastor said on this particular night, every Tuesday night they had prayer, he would be praying. And the pastor said, call his name. And everybody will say, Calvin, Lord, Calvin, Calvin, Calvin. Mm-hmm. This went on for weeks and weeks and weeks. Mm-hmm. And he said one night, a Tuesday night, he had taken his cocaine and he was in mm-hmm. this dog pen kennel. Mm-hmm. And he heard the name Calvin, 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 Calvin. And he walked from where he was. He couldn't take the bus public transportation because of his condition. And he walked from where he was to Brooklyn Tab. And he, Calvin, and everyone, head bow, praying, Calvin, Calvin, Calvin. And he walked in. Now they knew him because he was a member there. They knew him, Sister Bash. And he walked in. And the crescendo got louder. Calvin, Calvin, because they saw him coming in. The wife didn't see him. And he's bald. Calvin, and when she found that there was this excessive noise, and she looked, she saw the husband. And he was a stink and filthy as. Amen. But it doesn't matter how God brings you back.
Yes.
He brings you back.
Amen.
He changed the inside. The outside was nasty.
But he changed.
God wouldn't bathe you. You had to bathe. But he changed the inside.
Yes. Amen. Yes.
He changed the inside.
You had to take off the clothes. Amen. You have to strip yourself down. And,
you have to strip.
And, yeah.
Amen. And he sang a song, I'm cleaned.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus. Blessed.
Praise the Lord. Good night. You're on Choice Radio.
Hallelujah.
Hello. Hello. Praise the Lord. You're on Choice Radio.
Hallelujah.
Go ahead, Pastor.
Yes. He sang a song. I'm cleaned. I'm clean. I've been washed by the blood of the Lamb. Mm-hmm. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. No. Sin has its effect.
Mm-hmm.
Because the cocaine that he had been taking,
yes,
mm-hmm. sin has an effect on it, right? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Listen to this. Everything, David had the results. God told him, mm-hmm. the sword, although I would forgive you, mm-hmm. I have forgiven you. Yes, the sword would not depart from the house.
Yes.
The sword, sin has a consequence. Yes. There's a consequence to your action. Mm-hmm. When a young lady runs around, that's she gets pregnant, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The Lord is not going to take away the pregnancy. Mm-hmm. He took away your sin, your mm-hmm. act.
Mm-hmm.
Of it takes away that, but the pregnancy remains. Evidence of your running around.
Mm-hmm.
When a young man wants to go and runs around with ladies who are loose ones, when he gets AIDS, God forgive him of his mm-hmm. action, but the consequence of his action remains. Mm-hmm. And because Calvin had been taking cocaine and cocaine and cocaine through the what have you, mm-hmm. he died cancer of the throat.
Mm-hmm.
He died of cancer of the throat. Young mm-hmm. guy, cancer of the throat. But a saved person,
yes.
you see. A safe person.
Mm-hmm.
So that the results of Manasseh's action found root in the generation. It because for 55 years,
that's correct.
He ruled. That's a lifetime. 55 years is a very, very long time. It found root. And the Lord said, now it's time to act. I'm going to subdue you. Because he would never relent. He would never turn to God. God said, I'm going to subdue you now. You see, the funny thing is that we don't know when God is going to come. We don't know how he's going to come.
Yes.
We don't know how he's going to subdue us, mm-mm. right? Because we continue to be proud. His father, Hezekiah, at one time was proud, and God had to bring him down.
That's right.
Yes.
Right? So what, as they say, the lime don't fall far from the tree.
Yes.
Right? So that he was taken captive, taken to Babylon, a ring in the nose. Hmm. Meaning that when they took that nose, he had to run.
Otherwise, okay.
It would burst and he would meet to death. Right?
Yes.
And he went. And because of the seed that was planted in him, he sought forgiveness, and the Bible says he repented. Now, in John 3, we talk about John saying, I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness, repent and be baptized. And I did tell you then that repentance is turning around, turning your change, a change of lordships from the lordship of Satan to the lordship of Jesus Christ. Yeah. Amen. But the nice thing about, the nice thing about God when you repent, remember, you have a baggage.
Yes.
You have a baggage, Sister Bash. You have a baggage. You go to, you leave Satan with your baggage. He cannot help you with that baggage.
Nah.
On the contrary, makes it heavier and worse.
Yeah.
Right? You become a burden to him.
Yes.
But God says, come unto me.
All ye that labor.
And a heavy laden.
Which meaning you're carrying your baggage.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Take my yoke upon you. It is light. My burden. Right? He says, take it. So that the prodigal son returned with the baggage. God cleaned him up. Manasseh returned with the baggage. God cleaned him up. The Bible says that God heard
his cry.
His cry. Right? Now, there's another definition for repentance. It is the activity of reviewing one's actions and feeling contrite for it, or showing regret for the past wrong, right? It involves a commitment to one's personally changing his life, right? And it revolves around being responsible and friendly and humane. And they say it is necessary for the attainment of salvation. In other words, repentance without repentance, there is no salvation.
No salvation.
Without repentance, there is no salvation, because it's a turning around.
Yeah.
It's a turning around. Look, for 55 years, he had not called upon the name of the Lord. This is funny, eh? For 55 years.
And you know what's amazing, what the Bible says here, Pastor Pitt? After he ruled so viciously, the Bible says he humbled himself.
Amen. He humbled himself.
Humbled himself.
This is, you see, I tell you, this God, God moves in mysterious ways. He wants us to perform, right? Sir. God allow him to be vicious for 55 years.
Oh my goodness.
And then cause him to be humbled.
And when he called, God heard him.
Yes.
That's right.
Yes.
God heard him.
That's correct.
From the time he called, God heard him.
Wow.
God heard him. Got him released. So they had no choice.
This is why people have to realize that when you come to God, you have to come to God with humility. You can't come to God high-minded, and you can't come to God because you're a king. You come in to think that you rule as a king. Even Manasseh as king, God humbled him so low down.
Yes.
That he had no other choice but to humble himself.
He humbled himself. Yes. And God heard his prayer. You see, this is where this is the operative word. He humbled himself.
Yes.
He couldn't go with his pride and thinking he, just as Nebuchadnezzar.
Just as Nebuchadnezzar.
Himself.
That's correct.
King again.
That's
king
correct. Again.
Yes. Great king.
King.
Remember, he was the statue of gold. Daniel saw. He said, you, Nebuchadnezzar, the statue of gold. Yeah. Great fella. Nebuchadnezzar conquered Israel three times. 605, 595, and 568. Conquered Israel. Nebuchadnezzar. And then God now says, it's time for me to conquer you.
All right, now.
Conquered him. Had him like a donkey eating grass for 7 years. 7 years. 7 years. For a season. 7 years. 7 years. He humbled himself.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Thing about it is that beyond humbling himself, what did he do? Something that he never did.
Seek the Lord.
His life. He prayed. and ask God for forgiveness.
Mm-hmm. He sought the Lord. Yes. Amen. He sought God.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
This is it. Mm-hmm. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Mm-hmm. Amen. He sought God. And we are saying to you tonight, seek God.
Seek God.
Call upon him. He is not far that he wouldn't hear you. Mm-hmm. He's not deaf that he wouldn't hear you.
But yet he said, call upon him while he's near.
Yes, because there's a cut of time. There is a cut of time. There are many people we can tell you who refer to who God cut off, right?
Oh, yes.
Balthazar, the son of, grandson of Nebuchadnezzar.
Uh-huh.
Yes, he got vicious and fast and took the vessels of God and drank in it.
Yes.
And then the writing was on the wall. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Many tickle. Thou art weighed in the balance and not
found wanting.
And the definition of that is that means that you are found deficient. You've been found deficient. In other words, you're missing something.
Yeah.
That is the Lord God, and he did not seek God
because
he was too proud. And the Bible says that very night the Assyrians came in and slaughtered him.
And there's a word that the Bible always used in the Old Testament where God hears your supplication.
Yeah, he would hear it.
And when you think about the word supplication, which meaning you have to supply something worthwhile to God, which is your heart.
Your heart's cry.
We must understand this, brethren, that I've been telling people, the only person... Well, he's not a person. The only spirit that God would not have heard at the time was the devil himself. Right?
Mm-hmm.
God, the devil used Pharaoh. If Pharaoh had turned to God, God would hear him.
Oh, yes.
Right?
Yes.
God would hear him. If Cain had turned to God, God would hear him.
Yes.
If Esau had turned to God, God would hear him. Yes. Remember, God said, he told Abraham, the people in Sodom, I'll give them a chance.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I would give them a chance.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
I would give them a chance.
If.
But if... But they did not, right? Understand this. God is not so far that when you call him, he's not going to hear you. He hears you. God will always give you a chance to repent. He would always give you a chance to repent. But the onus is on you to accept that chance. The onus is on you.
Call us tonight. Join the conversation. It's 347-663-8638. We still have a few minutes going tonight, and we want you to call in and join our program tonight. I don't know. Someone seems like they were calling before and was not getting through, but call us tonight. 347-663-8638. Praise the Lord. Go ahead, Pastor Pitt.
Amen. You see, God would sometime test us. He test Manasseh's father, Hezekiah, he tests him.
Mm-hmm.
And because God knows the heart of everyone, he tests Hezekiah.
He doesn't test to know your heart.
He knows the heart.
Test him. You could know.
The sickness.
Amen.
Amen.
He tests.
Do you trust God in times of wellness only or in times of sickness?
Yeah.
Do you trust God when your belly is full and your pocket is full?
Okay.
Or you trust him when you have nothing at all?
That's a good one. I like that one.
But Pastor Petty tests you to bring out
there's something in you.
What you have in you.
This is what it's all about.
He tests
to see what you have in you, right? Job says, I know God, and when you would have tested me, I would come through the fire.
He knows.
Yes. He's going to test you.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
He's going to test you. Amen. When he does, what is going to come out? Have you reached that level in God so that when he tests you, his goodness is going to come out? His mercy is going to come out?
Yes.
His love is going to come out? Because each one must go through a test.
Yes.
I even think right now about Noah.
Uh-huh.
Look at the test that Noah went through.
Yes. Oh, yeah.
They cussed Noah.
Oh,
they threatened him. They did everything
120
possible.
120 years.
You know?
That's a long time to preach.
Yes.
120 years. But Noah was resolved in his heart that God had been talking to him.
Yes.
And he listened to God. He listened and he followed God's instructions. He followed God's instructions. And bam, when the flood did come, you see what happened?
That's right.
He was vindicated. Right?
Of course.
He was proof correct. Exactly what God says,
God
is going to do. Uh-huh. God is going to do.
Pastor Pitt, I want to ask the people out there a question. What are you going to do when your flood comes?
Mm. Amen. Hallelujah.
What are you doing right now where the water is almost to your chin, coming up to your nostrils? What are you doing in the flood? Answer that question tonight. Go ahead, Pastor.
Do you know, I looked at a documentary last night. They say in Antarctica, the ice is now melting.
Yes. All right.
And when it does, low-lying areas will be flooded with 10 to 15 feet of water. Low-lying areas in the entire Pacific, Europe, all around there would be flooded. Low-lying areas would be flooded, right? Because people are not listening to the warning. They're not talking about climatic changes. They're not taking this into consideration, the climatic changes. Changes would take place. The ozone layer is melting. People continue to burn fossil fluids and what have you, so and so and so. They're not changing the way of life. There's a price to pay for that kind of action.
And I will put in a little piece here. They continue to send rockets up into the sky. And burn up the ozone layer,
right? All that sort of thing that they're doing, right? So that, you see? So God, in some measure, in some small way, God has been speaking to his people through signs and wonders. God has been speaking to his people. And some are paying attention and some of us are not paying attention. But God has been warning us, right? He has been warning us, right? And these things would come to pass. So that if you find yourself not calling upon God, not seeking God while you can find him, you better start to call upon God now. Because there's coming a time when it's going to cut off. There's coming a time when it's going to cut off. God's not going to cut off, but you will be cut off. You'll be cut off, I can assure you. You'll be cut off, right? Because God has been speaking to us.
Just like Manasseh, he knew God. He saw who God was, and yet still he continued to do the things that God hated. And God spoke to Manasseh so many times before, showed him so many things, but he would not listen. Some of us out there are the same way today.
Sometimes you have to experience the wrath of God before you act on his goodness.
That's right.
Sometimes he has to display his wrath before you act on his goodness. And in this instant case, he showed his wrath towards Manasseh. He allowed the enemies to come in, take him, conquer him, put a chain in his nose, and he suffered the degradation and the shame and the humiliation, because now a king is taken with a chain, with a hook in the nose, like a common criminal, like an animal, and he's dragged through the streets. He loses his kingdom. He's placed in chains. He humbles himself. He humbled himself and he sought God and repented. He sought God. And the Bible says that God heard him. Now listen, God will only hear you when he sees that heart is contrite. An act of contrition must take place. Without the act of repentance, there can be no forgiveness of sins. God saw the heart was contrite and God was satisfied. Yes, he has now repented. He's now relented. And God saw the condition of the earth. I would now replace you where you were before. Amen. It reminds me in Joel. For God would replace the years that the locusts and the canker worms and the grasshoppers. The parasites would have eaten. God would return it to you. And then the Bible says, he said, I would rebuke the devourer for your sake. The explanation is God will say, that is enough.
That's right.
Because when the enemy comes in,
like a flood,
the Spirit of God will lift up a standard. Amen. When the enemy comes in, the Spirit of God will lift up a standard. Amen.
Pastor Whistling, we want you to talk to the people out there in your language. Let them know. Let them know that we love the people from your land, and we want you to talk to them right now in your language so that they will know what's going on here tonight.
Hallelujah.
Okay, this is Faith Life Ministry. We wish you every Tuesday. Nous vous merci parce que t'attendez nous à soir encore pour jeudi, mardi. Que bon Dieu bénisse. On pense que tout ça qui dit ou là, il y a un changement dans la vie ou parce que il est pas facile pour un peu le monde changer. Nous bénéfice bon Dieu. Et puis que nous supposons marcher, tant que j'amène ça, Manasseh fait lui.
li fait 45 ans la conduit une mauvaise vie devant bon Dieu li connaît que bon Dieu pas remet vie que l'a mené hein qui ça qu'il fait lui-même li continue malgré tout et puis 45 ans après li voit que ça le fait a pas bon li décide demander bon Dieu pardon et bon Dieu pas un mauvais bon Dieu il pas pardonner li pardonne le quand même li pardonne le parce que le connaît que ça t'a fait pas bon li connaît t'a venir côté le quand même parce qu'il te gain plan planter la caille depuis le commencement papa c'est ça qu'il était fait. Nous souhaitons que ça c'est un changement pour tout, quel que soit la vie où tu as mené avant, quel que soit la quantité ça vous fait, méchanceté ou bien ça que vous faites au monde, ou bien ça que au monde fait ou qu'un bel souker, ou le temps pour demander pardon. Parce que si vous demandez pardon, c'est plus facile de vous pardonner. Si vous ne demandez pas du tout, vous pensez que vous êtes grand ou qu'à faire 10 ans, ça ne va pas marcher pour vous. Continuez à parler avec bon Dieu, demandez le pardon pour le changer. Nous sommes dans Faith Life Ministry qui est dans 844 Claxon Avenue, between 51 et Utica. Le téléphone est 718-713-7515 que vous avez relevé pour prière parce que nous avons une délivrance prière qui est vendredi à 7h30, mercredi qui est étude de la Bible, puis le dimanche 11h30 pour 2h30. Si vous avez participé ensemble avec nous. Que bon Dieu bénisse nous, soyons retentants de nous. Si vous voulez reler ou parler ensemble avec moi, vous devez reler ou parler avec n'importe l'autre monde qui est sous panel là. Que bon Dieu bénisse
nous. Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you,
all
Jesus.
All right. This is Faith Life Ministry, 844 Claxon Avenue, between East 51st and Utica. The phone number is 718-713-7515. Please call us for anything. We have the Bible study on Wednesday, 7:30 to 9. Sometimes a little bit longer because deep in the story we're telling about. We have now on. We are now on Revelation.
Mm-hmm.
That's very interesting. Very interesting. This is the time to talk about it because everything going on right now.
Mm-hmm.
Thing you don't know, you might be not imagine. It's right now. When I was little in Christ, I was babe. I thought there's a beast will come in the middle of the sea, rise up with so many feet and so many on. This is not really that. That's thing different, very different. If you came, you would be participate. That would be very great. And then on Friday we got our deliverance service at 7:30 to 9 too. On Sunday we have 11:30 to 2:30 service on Sunday. Please call and participate. Bishop got some of the service too that you can be on it. If you're looking for a job, if you have a house you want to repair, you can call this number 2-718-773-7515. Please call us. Thank you.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. And you know, Pastor Pitt, let's finish off because we have a few minutes. And you know, the in verse 13 it said, then Manasseh knew that the Lord he was God.
I love that.
Yeah, you know, and it took an experience for him to realize that God.
Not only that, it shows that the seed was planted too, because he knew.
He knew.
But you see, sometimes we know, but it takes an experience for that knowing to come out, for that knowledge to come out.
Amen.
Because God takes us through. Look, I remember growing up, Pastor Peter, a lot of us went to the Catholic Church and we saw, you know, things happen and whatnot and so on. But, you know, that seed was planted. But we went our own way and we strayed and we did all what we have to do. But there come a time God brings us to the point where we have an experience.
That's why Moses said it. He says, I was glad when I was afflicted that I might learn your statutes.
Yes.
That is it. You know,
you would have reached a level. Where you can't go down anymore. Yes, you're down already anyhow. Yes. The only place you could go is
up.
Up. That's the time when you look up and you realize, hey, there is help up there, no?
Yes,
there is help up there.
Yes.
This is where he reached.
That's where he
remember reached. He had not spoken to God for 55
wow.
years.
Yes, yes.
That's a lifetime.
That's a lot of grace,
that's
years,
a lot
eh?
Of grace, yes.
Yes, sir.
You see, there's a reason why God allowed it for 55 years.
Yes.
It shows that God rules in the affairs of men. Yes. 55 years. Yes. That's a lot of years. That's a lot of years.
Mm-hmm.
And then after he was taken, then he said, oh, I remember my father was sick and he prayed so and so. The father would have told him and he prayed so and so. Okay. And because of the seed that the father had planted in his life, he remembered the Lord is God.
And he humbled himself.
Listen, not the Lord. The God.
No. The Lord.
His God.
His God.
His God.
His God.
Beautiful.
Yes.
The Lord. His God.
Because that God was his God from day one.
That's correct. Amen.
Yes.
He was always there. Yeah.
He was always
there. He was there.
He was there.
He was there for the Father.
Yeah.
He was there for the Father. Mm-hmm. And the Father planted that same seed in him. Amen. He was there for the Father.
Hallelujah.
And this is it. That seed would have been planted. Your old dear brethren, you're a Christian. Plant a seed in your children's life.
Mm-hmm.
Speak in their life. Yes. Speak in their life. Plant the seed.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
We thank you tonight. You are listening to Faith Life Ministry, Hour of Prayer. Faith Life Ministry is located at 844 Clarkson Avenue between East 51st and Utica Avenue. We want you to join us on Wednesday nights with our Bible study. We are studying the book of Revelation, and the man of God, Pastor Pitu, you have been hearing tonight, mostly in the discussion. Mm-hmm. And we were just following up with him. He's the teacher of our Bible study. And we want you to come and join with us Wednesday night. Right now, we are doing the book of Revelation, the end time book.
Amen.
Yes. Which is, when you look around you and you see ISIS and you see everything that's happening, believe you me, it's mentioned in the word of God. We want you to join us on a Wednesday night at 7:30 p.m. for our Bible study. And at Sunday morning worship and praise begins at 11:30 a.m. Come join us. We'd like you to be our guest Sunday morning for our worship and praise service. And we know that you will be blessed. On Friday night is our deliverance service. Come and pray with us. Come and see God work miracles. Come and see, let God deliver you from whatever situation you might be in. Join us in our deliverance service on Friday night. You are listening to the Hour of Prayer with Faith Life Ministries. We thank you for your listening here tonight. We know that God has done something for you. And if God did something for you tonight, we'll be back, God's willing, next Tuesday. You can call us and tell us what God did between tonight and next Tuesday night, God's willing. We thank you for your listening here tonight. And we're going to be off in a few minutes, but we're going to just play this song, and may God richly bless you.
Hallelujah.
spirit of heaviness go.
Amen.
Let your healing flow. And we thank God tonight for the opportunity. Right at this time, I'm going to ask the panel to introduce themselves and tell you something about themselves. And we're going to be out of here in a few minutes, God's willing.
Hallelujah, Pastor Batra. One more time. I hope and I pray that something touched you tonight. I know the weather may not be so nice, but we thank God that we can be in a warm place. Let's remember those that are on the outside. Let's pray for them, that somebody will supply for them while they're out on the outside. We thank God for you, and we hope and pray that we will meet again next week, God willing, and that you will make that call. Have a good night.
I just want to say the time is getting closer than you think. If I know you have to make a living on this earth, but don't forget, put everything behind and put God thing first. Pray more and ask God for a favor, for forgiveness, and repent. May God bless you tonight. And everything that's said may be a change to your life. This is Sister Wisleen again. Bonjour Benoît, swear. M'de bien content sama avec ou pour te capoter pour parole bon Dieu. Vini jouer nous. Nous souhaitons que ça ait un changement dans la vie. Ou que bon Dieu nous passe une bonne soirée dans nos Jésus.
Amen. Lennox Pitt saying goodbye and good night. We shall be here again on Tuesday when we possibly continue the discussion on repentance. I love you. God bless you. Real good. Amen.
Praise the Lord. This is Pastor Atwell saying grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God our Father. And from the Lord Jesus Christ. It's so good to be in your listening ears one more time. We thank God for all of you who joined with us in the program and those of you who have been listening but did not call in. We thank God for you anyhow. Mm-hmm. God is good and his mercies endure it forever. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. God bless you tonight. Have a blessed continued week in God's. Let God's grace and his mercy follow you through the rest of the week. Till we meet again, in Jesus' name. This is Faith Life Ministry, Hour of Prayer, saying good night and God bless.
So much better. Yeah.